Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage one more time, Mr. Bob Repass.
All right. Yeah, as you guys know, I'm a big Bruce fan. I love getting up here on the music, but the thunderstorm and special effects is pretty cool, so I'm going to have to work something out to have that as they bring it up here. All right, that was a great job, Eddie. Seth, appreciate you. All right, so yesterday afternoon we wrapped up with 3 note talks, and this morning we're going to get 2 more of those. So you guys have met our next speaker yesterday when she received the Lifetime Achievement Award. So if you guys will help me, welcome to the stage, Martha Speed.
I guess my mic is on, yes? Okay, I couldn't hear it. I'm excited to speak to you today about when life stories live on. we're going to talk about 5 elements that I believe help to build a legacy. You see, the first thing that we think about when we start thinking about legacy is our financial legacy. But I think there are so many other things that come into place that help to build legacy. You see, when people share their knowledge and wisdom with us, it has an impact on our lives and what we accomplish. And I think we then want to do the same thing for someone else that we love. My dad was a very intentional gift giver. So when we were young, he started gifting us with things like municipal bonds. Well, when you're 15, it's a little bit hard to understand why you're getting a municipal bond that does not going to pay you for 30 or 40 years. That's a really long time out in the future when you're 15, 16 years old. But as an adult, when we had situations like a child graduating from high school, going into college, and college tuition's about $30,000 or $40,000 now. It's pretty high. It's pretty high up there now. That made an impact on our lives. And what about the big day for our daughter? Weddings are expensive. Or maybe we were just going through a financial struggle, and just all of a sudden we would have some extra money to help pay for it because some of those bonds would pay off. You see, life experiences help us understand the vision that someone else had for us. And then the stories that we share with others, it clarifies that person's influence that they had over our lives. It leaves an indelible mark. That's what I want to do for my kids. That's what we need to do for other people. We need to leave an indelible mark. Do you guys remember Get Smart? Agent Maxwell Smart. He was a secret agent. He worked for control. Remember back then that was the CIA. It aired in 1965. I was about 8 years old, and I can remember to this day watching on black and white TV, and all of my siblings and I, we were just there and laugh at Agent Smart because he was so inept at using all the gadgetry that he had. He had it everywhere, all over, but he couldn't use any of it. And I can totally relate. I have a lot of technology just right at my fingertips, and I can't use any of it. So I have to get somebody else from the next office to come over and fix the speaker so I can get on a conference call or get on Zoom, right? So I understand how that works.
That's a true story, by the way.
See, even people here in the audience know. So he is, so Agent Smart, you know, he's trying to use the phone that's been embedded in his shoe. And my dad comes walking through the living room and stops, and he's watching with us for a minute, and he says, they have the technology to put that phone into a watch. He said, but the technology is so advanced, the public is not ready for it. 50 years later, in 2015, Apple launched the Apple Watch. That's a visionary. See, a visionary is someone that is a long-term strategic thinker for the future. My dad was thinking 50 years in advance. He wasn't creating, of course, the technology that went into that smartwatch, but what he was doing was he was always projecting cash flow. What he really wanted, though, was a situation where if anything ever happened to him, that my mom would be taken care of for her lifetime. And because of the investments that he made so many years ago, back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, my mom, who is now 82, has never needed anything. You see, my dad did not think of a transaction as a one-time occurrence. It was multiple transactions over the lifetime of the loan. So if he bought a note every month to him, every time that payment came in, it was a transaction. You see, he knew what he was doing. You buy one note, but it pays for a long time. My dad was a go-giver. We've got to be generous with our time and our money. Eddie and I adopted the go-giver phrase from our friend Jason Medley, who is the founder of Collective Genius. The way that Jason determines how much income he wants to make every year is based on how much he wants to give away. How much does he want to give to charities? My dad was benevolent and financially gave a lot to very many different causes. But one in particular that I chose to share with you this morning was an orphanage that he supported, the Baptist Children's Village. And he had specific things that he donated to them. He donated all of the meat that they needed and all of the shoes. And I wondered about that sometime, and at one point in time, he shared it with me. He said, when those kids sit down to dinner at night, I want them to have the same thing that we have on our table. I want those kids to have the same thing that you're wearing. You see, it wasn't second best. He didn't give them any less than he gave us. It was the same. He wanted them to have the same. You see, I consider that giving, you know, those type of gifts, kind of planned giving. You know, a good example of that would be an inherited IRA. That would be planned giving. So let's talk about some strategy. You've got to be very strategic about how you're going to reach your goals. So my dad had two different pools of money. So you had what was called a salary. And a salary is what you live on. You don't live above your means. You live within your salary. And then you had investment money, which was the other pool. The majority of my dad's was, of course, notes and then rentals. He had a lot of rentals. So you've got passive income coming in. And then as that income comes in, you take the money there and you reinvest that money. So you've got to think about reinvesting with the money, the profit that your investments are making. this might be a little bit of an extreme story, but my dad made a financial mistake one time on a rental property, and he had to recoup the loss pretty quickly. And so I'm sure there were multiple ways that he could have done that, but he sold our car, the family car, the one car we all shared. Yes, so I remember well because my dad worked, he walked to work for a year. That whole year he walked to work. And guess what? Guess what all the kids had to do too? We had to walk everywhere too. Now I remember the early morning of getting on the bus at 6:30. We were the first ones on and we were the last ones off about 5:30 in the afternoon. It was a long day for kids back then. That was a long day. You see, the life experience that he went through then, that mistake, I think what he did gave him a crystal clear vision not to ever make that mistake again. So we've got to learn from our mistakes and not do that again, right? Let's talk a little bit about integrity. So I heard, I guess Bob it was explaining who was going to speak today, and Grant Kemp is going to speak today, this afternoon, and he's a really smart young guy. We really think he has the right perspective about a lot of things. And part of his mission statement is doing the right thing, especially when it's not in your favor. Doing the right thing, especially when it's not in your favor. You see, I think that that is part of Grant's legacy. I think someone had an influence in his life or had an impact on him in some way, and that got ingrained in him that he is going to do the right thing, especially when it's not in his favor. And you know what? As I've built and as you guys build like your IRA accounts or your retirement accounts or however you're growing for the future, you're going to need a person of integrity to be a financial friend for you. So it's really important to be a person of integrity. And everybody wants somebody that's a person of integrity on their team. Let's talk about the next level, because we've got to continue the reinvestments if we want to push out a financial legacy to our children and our grandchildren. See, the next level for Eddie and I was that we had to go learn how to structure the buy long, sell short model, or the partial model, and make it work for self-directed retirement accounts. Because it's fairly new. I mean, my dad didn't use that type of account. So we had to go perfect it. And as you heard Nathan say yesterday, not did it only take a lot of creativity on Eddie's part, but it took a lot of phone time and in-person time with Nathan and Quincy on the phone, just thinking through different strategies. And I'd call and say, well, this worked. No, you can't do that. We, you know, you got to think through these things, right? But we finally got down to the creation of the partial models that we use today and that we teach today for self-directed retirement accounts. So these models give us a way to continually reinvest and always be in reinvesting for the future. So I think my dad would have really been proud of the effect of where we are with all of that today. So there are different stages for different ages, and I just want to talk quickly. I'm going to go through this, but there are four generations. We've got great-grandma now. Now I'm grandma. We've got my children's generation, and then, of course, the next generation, our grandkids. We only have one. This is Colt, so I hope some of you, I know some of you saw him yesterday. So the way that we've been able to structure by reinvesting, you see, when my mom gets a lump sum of money in her account, we take that money and we reinvest it in notes, right? So then that keeps that cash flow coming in. And so we've continually done this. My dad's been gone for 22 years. So we've been kind of helping her to keep her investments going. And so what has happened as a result of that is what my dad did all those years ago, and then what we've continued to do, benefits my mom. We have it structured that it will benefit my generation, and we also have it structured to where some of the things that my mom has, some of the assets, will then benefit my children's generation. Who knows if we'll be able to continue that to benefit the next generation, but that might be possible. And then, for example, I have an IRA that I could use, or if I don't ever need to take any money out of my Roth IRA, my kids will benefit from that. I could even go so far as to let my grandkids benefit from that if I wanted to make them beneficiaries. Then the same thing with wood. It just continues on, but the way it has continued on is to make these reinvestments over and over again. So, and then there's all kinds of different accounts that we could create that would benefit Colt and potentially the next generation. So to me, legacy is more than just the financial part of it. It is giving to future generations through your visions, your strategies, teaching them to be go-givers, teaching them to be a person of integrity, teaching the next generation how to build for the future. We have to teach them that. And then they can carry forward the legacy to the next generation. So let me leave you with this today. Get focused, have 2020 vision, and start building for the future in 2020. Thank you.